Assalamu alaikum. Please do not watch this video segment if you are busy or distracted. Please find a peaceful, quiet place and time to watch. Please do not watch this video segment if you are running, or if you are walking, or if you're exercising. This video segment contains information that will change everything you know about the Quran. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri. وَحْلُلْ عُقْدَةً مِنْ لِسَانِي يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي. This is part 4 of the series called Who Frowned and Refused to Answer the Blind Man. This is an interpretation of Surah Abasa, Surah 80 from the Quran. I remind you that if you have not seen the earlier video segments in this series, to please stop immediately and go watch the first and the second and the third part in this same series. Just to give you a brief summary, in part 1 we demonstrated that the traditional story which is reported about Surah Abasa in all the books of Tafsir and all the translations about the Quran, that story, which is based on what's called Asbabun Nuzul, really does not fit based on other historical reports, if you want to accept those historical reports as a basis for interpreting the Quran. It does not fit with the Quranic description of Prophet Muhammad's manners and character. It does not fit with the Quranic description of the earliest companions, among whom Abdullah ibn Maktum, the blind man, about whom this story is supposed to be. It does not fit with the Quranic definition of Rasul, and this is very significant. Please go back to part 1 to really learn about this issue and understand why their traditional interpretation of Surah Abasa is absolutely erroneous. In part 2, we demonstrated how the Quranic stories have a style of their own. Again, please, if you have not seen those parts, go back and review those two parts. We detailed the story of the man who died for 100 years and was then revived after 100 years. And we put them side by side and we explained that this is a very plausible explanation. That was not the proof in part 2. In part 3, we provided direct Quranic proof and we talked about the methodology foundations. We provided two methodology foundations, including a significant tool that allows us to understand all the stories of the Quran. We demonstrated also the power of the Abrahamic locution, and I hope that you have benefited from part 3. In part 3, we also started the translation and interpretation of Surah Abasa, and we discussed several critical new concepts. Now, in this part, which is gonna be long, it's gonna be detailed, it's gonna be full of information, and it will be the best segment so far of the whole series. In this segment, we provide 4 new methodology foundations. That's a total of 6. We present a brand new science of Quranic cognitive psychology, something you've never heard of, a model for all future research based on the Islamic model from within the Quran. We will provide a summary of the methodology process that I follow for engaging the Quran. And this is something that most of you have asked about. And inshallah, this will provide very clear elaboration on some of the steps that we follow for this methodology. We also have a surprise for you in this segment. There's a brand new surah that you did not expect. We are going to provide the full translation of this relatively short surah, a very important surah. We will complete the translation of Surah Abasa, the remainder of Surah Abasa that we did not cover in the prior segments. However, the interpretation of this part of Surah Abasa will not be understandable without all the rest of everything else we present in this segment. And thus, this segment is long and this segment is full of information. But I promise you, if you stick with this segment all the way to the end, you're going to discover amazing things about the Quran and you're going to open a new world of viewing the Quran in ways that you've never even imagined. I promise you that if you understand and apply these concepts in this segment, you're going to have access to information and privileged knowledge that 90% of the scholars don't have. They don't even know that they don't have. In other words, they don't know to even ask and learn about it. So inshallah, because of this segment, we will be able to access new information that will spread a brand new type of awareness within the Muslim Ummah for the future, inshallah. Finally, there are seven new gifts in this segment, including the mother of all gifts, something you could not even fathom. You cannot even imagine how beautiful and significant it is to engaging the Quran. And there is a very special gift all the way to the end of the segment. So please don't miss any part of the segment because you will be missing a lot. Having said that, we remind you that this is not an entertainment type of segment. This is not for entertainment purposes. We're not just telling stories. We are presenting an academic research. We are not just interested in giving you the answers. We also want to demonstrate the organic Quranic methodology so that you see for yourself that you should not trust any other interpretation or translation that does not use this Quranic methodology. This Quranic methodology, I remind you, is fully derived from within the Quran. We did not make it up. We did not think of it. We did not enjoy it because we thought it's cool. It's none of that. It's from the Quran itself. We also remind you that we refer to the Abrahamic locution, a concept that is part of this Quranic methodology. We will demonstrate again in this segment how relevant and important this concept is to understanding the Quran. We will rely on the concept of schema or umniyya that we discussed in prior segments, and the concept of Weltanschauung, which is arsh, again we discussed in prior segments. I will put links to both of these segments in the description box below. If you don't know what these concepts are, please stop right now because you won't understand this segment and you will send all sorts of comments that don't make sense because you don't have the background required to understand the information in this segment. This is new information for 99.99% of the Muslims. So if you've not built the vocabulary and the concept and the intellectual background which we use in this series, you won't enjoy this segment at all and you will think we're making things up. Just to remind you a little bit, we will reiterate the concept of yadhakkar and the concept of dhikra, which are mentioned in ayah 4 of Surah Abasa. This is a brand new schema for most of you. This is a brand new umniyya. And again, we discussed it in prior segments on this channel. In a way, this segment is the essence of the whole channel. This is why this whole channel is established, to teach you how to engage in the verb yadhakkar and how to engage in dhikra. Again, if you don't understand these concepts, go back to part 3 and really analyze and understand these concepts and internalize them. So to summarize, the verb yadhakkar is a purely Quranic term that has nothing to do with the language of the Arabs of the 7th century. This is not a word they used. This is purely a Quranic term. It means to sow the seeds in your own Weltanschauung, in your own arsh, by asking questions with humility, with patience, with persistence on engaging the Quran, and being available to receive new knowledge. And this is significant, because without being available to receive new knowledge, your cup is already full. There's no room for new knowledge to come in. And that's why we keep talking about approaching the Quran with an empty cup, approaching the Quran with humility, with submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Him to teach us. Now, the concept of dhikra we defined as the spontaneous recollection of the divine guidance, which is defined according to the Abrahamic locution with the term al-ma, the water. It's not just water, it's a divine sustenance. It's a divine irrigation. It's a divine liquid that comes down upon us that is deposited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly to repair and to restore and to reform our Weltanschauung. At this point, we need to offer one more detail. The question that we ask up here, when we said we ask questions with humility, this question or this type of question identifies specific conflicts or defects that relate to one or more of our own schemas, our own umniyya within our Weltanschauung, arsh. Please understand this concept. Take the time to really reflect. Every time you ask a question there is some sort of a conflict, some sort of something that doesn't fit between what you're reading, what you think you're reading, versus what is already in your omniya, in your schema, in your intellectual makeup, in the framework that you think you see the world based on. And therefore, these questions have to be approached with humility. You have to think that not everything in your own framework is correct. And that's where the importance of humility in asking these questions come in. So the divine water that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides, al-ma', which is the divine guidance, as we said, addresses that specific defect. It's preening it. It is reforming it. It's repairing it on your behalf. So this is the concept of yadhakkar, and this is the concept of dhikra. And again, this is extremely important for this whole segment, and we hope that you pay close attention to these issues and really understand them before you proceed. So in that sense, Allah is the restorer of your Weltanschauung, your personal Weltanschauung. Allah is engaging you on your own terms to help you repair the defects and the errors in your own schemas, in your own omniya that are part of your Weltanschauung. So this is what the Quran refers to as shifa. It describes itself shifa. Why? Because when you discuss issues from within the Quran and ask these questions, you're really healing. You're healing your Weltanschauung. You're repairing it. You're fixing it. That's the definition of shifa according to the organic methodology that we use and according to the Abrahamic locution. I want to remind you that dhikra takes time. It is not something that happens instantaneously. It happens spontaneously, we said, but it may take time before it materializes, before it actually occurs in your mind. So the correct understanding does not happen at will. It's not something you decide, I want it now and I will get it now. No, first you ask the question and then you let it hang. You let it mature in your own mind. You let it brew. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will choose the time. Allah will choose the process or the way He gives you this divine irrigation, this divine water, this divine ma' to repair your Weltanschauung. When it happens, it appears to you as a flash of insight. Sometimes you don't know where it comes from. And sometimes you will read something that will trigger your memory. Sometimes somebody says something in front of you. Or sometimes Dr. Haney says something to you and then makes sense. It provides the illumination that is required for you to correct that omniya, that schema, that Weltanschauung that we talked about. I want to remind you that for some of you who are enjoying this process of dhikra, and some of you are already doing so, and they've written to me and told me about this, please remember, never ever take credit for this. This is not yours. This is not knowledge that you toiled on and produced out of your own abilities. This is purely from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You only had a very small part in seeding, in sowing that little seed, which is a question, which indicates that you don't know. By sowing that seed, coming to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with an empty cup, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds by granting you this gift. So it's a gift from Allah. And that's why we continuously say on this channel, this whole ilm, everything we talk about in this channel, is a gift from Allah, not just to me, to all mankind. And that's why we're sharing it. And inshallah, we will be able to continue to share it with your support and your dua. Remember the concept of naskh. We discussed this in an earlier segment. Again, I will put the link for that in the description box below, which means abrogation. Abrogation is not about eliminating or annulling some verses of the Quran, of the scriptural text. It is about repairing false or erroneous or mistaken assumptions and notions in your own Weltanschauung. And we discussed this fully before. Finally, never trust a dhikra. So you think you have a dhikra, a spontaneous idea, and you become enamored with it. And you love it and you think it's the right answer. Stop. You should not fall in love with that dhikra at first glance. You should further proceed to confirm and to rigorously verify that this opinion or this idea that flashed in your mind is actually from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A little later we will discuss a few issues related to this concept of validation or confirmation and verification. So just be patient and stay with us all the way until the end of this segment, inshallah, and you will learn a lot more. I want to remind you at this point to take a few seconds, if you have not subscribed, to please subscribe to this channel. And if you are already a subscriber, please click the red bell button, which gives you the immediate notification. It also helps this channel greatly because it tells the Google and YouTube search engines that other people should have access to this information. So please spread this knowledge by doing this little thing, which is clicking the red button. Of course, you should share and comment and ask questions if you don't understand something. Now we move forward with the methodology foundations. Remember, in part three, we gave you two examples. In part four, which is this part, we give you a few more examples from the methodology foundations. And again, many of you have been asking about the methodology, and we're trying to be responsive as much as possible to provide details to the extent that we can as we proceed and build this ilm one concept at a time for you. We need to remind you that it is not enough to take one word from the Abrahamic locution that you've learned or you discovered through this channel and plug it in into the old, traditional, existing, flat interpretation of the Quran. So in other words, if a verse has been interpreted one way or translated one way, and I tell you or you discover that the Abrahamic locution for that one term in that one verse, one ayah, is something else, such as the example of ard. So you cannot just take the word ard, replace it with a new understanding, and keep everything else in the verse according to the old translation or the old interpretation. You have to understand that this is a coherent, consistent, systematic understanding of the Abrahamic locution. So just to remind you, when we discuss this ayah in part 3, ayah 13:4 from Surah Ar-Ra'd, we said al-ard means the scripture, qita means something else, mutajawirat means something else, jannat means something else, a'nab refers to something else, zara, every single word, every single term, even the verbs, even the way the expressions are composed within these verses need to be taken in consideration according to the Abrahamic locution. So please keep that in mind. It is not just one term, plug it in and everything happens like magic. It does not work that way. You have to work diligently on every term, every word, every expression, even the pronouns, even moving the position of an object versus a subject changes the meaning of the whole sentence. So there are a lot more details to this than some of you have been asking about in some of the comments and some of the private emails that you have sent me. So this is the first principle, first example from the methodology foundations. The second example, or example number four in total, something we already addressed, the concept of ard as a scriptural text. And we talked about the divine rain, al-ma, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings down, the divine irrigation to help us repair the Weltanschauung. Okay, very well. So now the obvious question is, where does the rain come from? According to the Abrahamic locution, according to this systematic, thematic collection of terms and expressions in the Quran, where does the ma come from? Now, those of you who are familiar with the style and the structure and the examples and reading the Quran know very well that al-ma, the divine rain, the divine guidance, comes down from as-sama or as-samawat. And therefore, we have to ask, what are samawat? And this is, again, the new foundation that we're building for this methodology. Now, I put this cut and paste segment from a lexicon called Lisan al-Arab. Ibn Manzur al-Afriqi is the one who composed and assembled this lexicon called Lisan al-Arab. It's a very old, traditional dictionary, but very extensive, and it includes so many different meanings and interpretations for every single term, especially the gerunds of the Arabic language. This is very important because I am receiving a lot of concerns and complaints from my Arabic-speaking brothers, and they don't trust that we have done significant research before we present anything to you. And this is just one example. And I'm going to show you, and those of you who speak Arabic are going to be shocked, and you should be shocked, because there is much that we have not been taught in our traditional training and education of the Arabic language. I'm going to give you the example so that you see for yourself with your own eyes that things we take for granted are not necessarily true. The word samawat in the Quran has this double A in here, samawat, samawat. You don't pronounce it samawat. It's not a single A in here. Watch this. In Lisan al-Arab, and again, this is a cut and paste entry under the term sama, sama, which means to elevate or to rise or to raise above you, right? He says very specifically, as-samawat, watch how it's written. Watch how it's written right here. It is written without an alif after the meme. It is not samawat, it's samawat. And again, he says the plural of sama is samawat, not samawat. Now, in the Quran, this word right here, samawat, which is a single A, not double A, a single A, the word samawat does not occur in the Quran. Never the Quran uses the word samawat, which is the plural of sama. This is very critical, and I hope you are learning to be honest and to be modest and to be humble in receiving new knowledge. We are told that samawat is the plural of sama, which means the heavens or the skies above us, and all sorts of scholars have built a whole career on interpreting scientific miracles of the cosmology and the heavens and the skies and multiple layers of the atmosphere and all of this. None of this is in the Quran. The Quran is not talking about samawat, this word right here, samawat. I'm going to enlarge it because I really want you to see it. This word, samawat, without the alif after the meme, it's not a double A, it's a single A in the lexicon. In the Arabic language, samawat exists. In the Quran, samawat is never used. So what is samawat? Here's the answer, and I put this little chart in here so you can see a little bit better. So samawat, the one right here, I'm circling with the mouse, is the one from the Arabic language, from the common Arabic. It is the plural of sama'a or samawa. And sama' is plural also. Both words, sama' and samawat, samawat, short ma, samawat, is in the common Arabic, plural for what's above you, something above you, physically, usually physically. So samawat in the Quran is a different word. Watch this little alif in here. This is called alif al-khinjariya. Anyone who memorizes the Quran or learns to do tajweed, if he says samawat, he made a mistake. It is samawat, both long alifs. This is exclusively in the Quran. This is a plural of what? The answer is, it is the plural of where this divine rain comes from. It is the plural of the Quranic concept of the source of this divine rain, the source of this divine mercy and guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides to specific people. So when we read as-samawati wal-ard, as we shall see in many examples, we're talking about al-ard being the scriptural text and samawat, the layers of understanding above it, from which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings this divine rain to irrigate your Weltanschauung and repair it and help you improve your access to the divine guidance in the Quran, inshallah. I hope this is clear. Now, if we review, we talked about this before, the concept of where are the ayat, and I'm going to give you a very quick example. Very quick example of where ayats are, or what are the ayats. Remember, ayah means sign. So therefore, the question is, what is ayah? Where does it reside? And remember, we talked when we talked about nasikh and abrogation, we said ayat are here in your Weltanschauung. Ayat are not on paper. And I'll give you an example. Let's say you are an investigator and you go to a crime scene and you see the butt of a cigarette that is squished on the floor. And to most people, this may not mean anything. But to an astute, trained investigator, you recognize that this is related to the action that surrounded that crime. And therefore, you start thinking that we may need to look for someone who smokes. Perhaps the specific brand of the cigarette means something. Perhaps the way someone crushed that cigarette without completing it all the way means something. Of course, this is an indication to the investigator, but an untrained eye is just the butt of a cigarette. It doesn't mean anything. And this is exactly the concept of ayat. So ayat exists in your own comprehension, not on paper. It is not the cigarette itself that is a sign. It is how that investigator understood that cigarette butt that made it a sign for him, that made it a part of the evidence, that made it an ayah. So the understanding of the ayah is up here in your Weltanschauung. It is not on paper. It's not the word itself that becomes an ayah. It's how you reflect on it and grasp it and understand its implication and its indication that makes it a sign, an ayah. And therefore, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to you that ayah is coming from samawat. That revelation to you personally is part of that divine rain coming down from samawat. So samawat, just to summarize, is the layers of understanding, the layers of understanding above the text, above the text. It's a metaphorical representation of all the different layers of understanding. And as we know, the Quran has many layers of understanding, not just one. That is referred to in the Quran as samawat, long double A in both, after the meem and after the waw. So let's look at an example. And this is extremely important. I need you to really pay attention and stay alert. This is a beautiful ayah from Surah Al-Anbiya, Surah 21, Ayah 31. أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ كَانَتَا رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ أَفَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ وَجَعَلْنَا فِي الْأَرْضِ رَوَاسِيَ أَن تَمِيدَ بِهِمْ وَجَعَلْنَا فِيهَا فِجَاجًا سُبُلًا لَعَلَّهُمْ يَهْتَدُونَ. So the translation that we provide for this ayah is very interesting. Have those who rejected, in other words, people of earlier scriptures who have rejected. So the translation of this ayah, according to our methodology and our Abrahamic locution that we use in this channel, have those who rejected, i.e. the people of earlier scriptures who rejected the Quran, have they not seen already how the samawat, meaning the layers of understanding, were bound to the scriptural text before, but with the Quran, they became separated from each other? What? They're separated. Yes, it's exactly what this ayah says. كَانَتَا رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا. They were together, they were attached in every other human piece of literature before, but with the Quran, these two are split from each other. You read the text, it does not mean you understand it. You read the text, there is another process that needs to happen, which is the understanding has to come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let me repeat it. This is extremely significant. Everything before the Quran, you read it, you understand the words, you understand exactly what the author of that text is trying to tell you from engaging the words directly. With the Quran, the layers of understanding and the layer of the scripture are separate from one another. Reading the text does not mean you understand it. You have no guarantee whatsoever that if you read the text, you will receive the correct understanding. This is unique to the Quran. This is absolutely amazing discovery, amazing declaration in this ayah in front of you. Samawat, the layers of understanding, and Al-Ard, which is the scriptural text itself, they were together. They were smushed together before the Quran. With the Quran, they are split. They're no longer attached to one another. فَتَقْنَاهُمَا. The word فَتَقْنَاهُمَا, we ripped them apart. We split them apart. We did not leave any direct attachment between the layer of understanding and the scriptural text. I hope you appreciate what we're saying. This is significant. Let's continue. And we made out of the divine water, مِنَ الْمَاءِ. This is exactly what we're talking about. كل شيء حي, everything that's alive. In other words, in order for these ayat, this textual scripture ayat, the verses, to become alive, you need this rain, you need this divine water, you need the divine guidance from Allah. The layers of understanding have to pour this irrigating liquid upon your Weltanschauung, so these ayat become alive in your Weltanschauung, in your own umniyah. And now you have a new umniyah, because this schema that grew as a result of this divine water is gonna guide you to understand more and more and more. And this is the process of repair that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about all through the Quran. Will they not believe? أَفَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. This is addressing again those who have refused the Quran. And we established within the scriptures text, رواسي. This is another word. Again, we cannot understand one word at a time and assume that we keep the rest of the ayat according to the old interpretation. And we established within the scriptures text, رواسي, meaning anchoring principles. رَسَى, that means to anchor, or to drop down, or to firm up against the ground. So there are things that anchor you. These are the principles. Lest misinterpreting the scripture causes them to go astray. And we established within it, meaning within al-ard, because this is talking about the scripture's text, al-ard. And we established within it, al-ard, meaning the scriptural text, connected waterways of ma', of divine guidance. Perchance they find guidance if they follow them. So what is this talking about? This is talking about the linking that we constantly do. When we do a nested interpretation, we're following an ayah, and then we take one word and see the links for it in all other parts of the Quran. This is fijajan subulan, connected ways that are grooved throughout the scriptural text. Why? Perhaps they shall find guidance if they follow them. So now this verse is not talking about the heavens above, or the Big Bang, or the way the planets separate from other planets, or the way black holes, none of this stuff. It is talking about a methodology instruction related to how to engage the Quran. Has nothing to do with all of these latest scientific discoveries that unfortunately some scholars have made a career out of grabbing and then applying over the Quran. Just like the people who did the old interpretations did with the language of the poets, we have scholars who are grabbing scientific discoveries and applying them over the Quran, claiming that this must be what the Quran is talking about without any direct evidence whatsoever. Here, the evidence is very clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about as-samawat, which are the layers of understanding, and al-ard, which is the scriptural text. They were bound together before the Quran. In all other scriptures, with the Quran, they become split, separated. You have access to the text. It does not mean you have access to the layers of understanding. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in this clear ayah, a brand new process of engaging the divine text, which is the Quran. So now we come to what I promised you at the beginning, which is the mother of all gifts, which is this concept that we just discussed. The fact that the text is not attached directly to the understanding of the text. These two are split. They're ripped apart with the Quran. This will explain so many things. It's just amazing discovery, and this will give you access to privileged knowledge that 90% or even more of the so-called scholars don't even know to look for, don't even know to go to learn. This is what the Quran is talking about. So in order to deal with this mother of all gifts, I decided to respond to a comment from a subscriber. The comment said, why did Allah have to disguise Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as Zulkarnain? Isn't it confusing for his slaves, meaning the people who are engaging in following the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What is Allah's purpose in making things difficult to understand? Wasn't the Quran meant to reach most people and not just some scholars who could crack the code? Is that the way how a holy book should be understood? Riddles and puzzles, etc., and multiple interpretations, making it confusing for the ummah? very legitimate question in many ways, but you will see the answer is very, very simple. The understanding of the Quran is not inside the text. Let me repeat it. The understanding of the Quran is not inside the text of the Quran. It is split. It's ripped apart from the text. The understanding comes directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The understanding of the ayat of the Quran is deposited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have very little to do with actually extracting the understanding from the ayat. I hope you understand what we're saying. We're saying something very significant, something nobody has touched on even, something nobody has alluded to, and we are presenting the details and the evidence for it in this segment. You may be asking, what does this have to do with Surah Abasa? Just be patient, because all of these concepts, as I said, are necessary to understand the significance of the last few verses of Surah Abasa. So before we get to the last few verses of Surah Abasa, we have to go through these concepts and really understand them and extract the maximum amount of wisdom from them so that we can understand the rest of Surah Abasa. So this is a completely new Islamic science of cognitive psychology. Cognitive psychology deals with the science of how we learn, how we think, how we reflect, how our psychology and our makeup affect what we understand. This is a brand new way of cognitive psychology. It's an Islamic cognitive psychology. And I urge all of those students who are studying psychology to go investigate this concept further. Not only one dissertation will come out from this. Many, many PhD dissertations will come out from this single discovery, I promise you. This understanding will help us in understanding our relationship with the divine. And again, it's part of the submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in order to understand how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us in our engagement of the Quran, we have to first realize that the understanding is not the product of our own cognitive processes. The understanding is a gift from Allah, always. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءٍ. They only encounter any parts of knowledge from Him to the extent that He wills, that He desires. So if you are watching this segment or any other segment of this channel, and alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed you with receiving an understanding, it is not Dr. Hani who gave you this knowledge. It's Allah who allowed the rain to come upon you to receive this divine guidance, to receive this divine ilm. And that's why we keep saying this ilm is a divine gift to all mankind. The second part of this knowledge is epistemology itself, the concept of epistemology, which is a philosophical word that means where is the source of knowledge. According to this new science of cognitive psychology, the basis of all human knowledge is a gift from Allah. Remember in part 3, we discussed briefly Isaac Newton and how his process went, where he would ask the question and sit and wait. And sometimes it takes him hours, sometimes it takes him days, sometimes it takes him weeks. I, myself, told you that there was one ayah in Surah Yusuf that took me 7 years before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permitted me to fully understand its broad implications. Such is the reception of understanding. The layers of understanding are separate from the text itself. The sooner you come to accept this concept and fully surrender to it, the sooner you will start enjoying the jannat, the paradise, the gardens, the secret abodes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for you. So we continue with something really critical. This is a page that if I could urge you to memorize it in full, please take the time and print it, copy it, you know, take a photo shot of it, whatever you want, memorize this page right here. So splitting understanding the Quranic text from the Quranic text is extremely relevant to so many questions people ask all the time. The first question is, why does the Quran claim it is inimitable? You cannot imitate it. You cannot come up with anything like it. This is part of the reason. Because the splitting of understanding of the text from the text itself, the two are not attached. You can't understand the text by just scanning or parsing the words or reflecting on the relationship between one word and another, or the kasra and fatha and dhamma. All of those things are important, but that's not where understanding comes from. Understanding comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when and if He wills for you to do so. The second question is, when we ask why is it difficult to understand, that question becomes irrelevant, inappropriate to ask. The correct question to ask becomes, why am I not able to receive the understanding? That's a logical question. That is a correct question. That is a humble question. That is the type of question that will drive you to work on yourself so that you can receive the understanding. So don't ask of the Quran why it is complicated. Ask of yourself, why are you not available to receive the understanding? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised us to give us the understanding. Allah promised us that this Quran shall guide you if you engage it correctly, if you engage it according to its own terms, if you engage it with the right conditions in you. So don't ask why is the Quran complicated. Ask why are you not available to receive the understanding from Allah. Because the understanding is not in the text itself. It doesn't matter how long you look at the text. That's not where understanding comes from. Understanding comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third question that this issue of splitting the understanding from the Quranic text answer is, why was the Quran preserved by Allah? Why does the Quran claim that it is preserved by Allah? Because of this reason. The Quran is the text that's preserved because it is the foundation for everything you do to receive the understanding. It is this formula that you have to apply. It is this formula that you have to engage. It is this text that you have to engage exactly the way it is. No changes, no modifications, and Allah preserved it for you. This is one of the biggest gifts to all mankind. The gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of the preservation of the Quran is phenomenal. It is a beautiful gift, if only people knew. This also answers the question, why our beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never explained the Quran? Of course, because the explanation is not in the text. The explanation comes direct to you. The explanation and the understanding of the Quran is not from human beings. So no matter what Dr. Hani on this channel is saying, this is just examples. This is just how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed me to express a few things. You, on the other hand, will need to engage the scripture, the text, and then wait for that divine rain, al-ma', to come down from as-samawat and allow Allah to open up new horizons of understanding that maybe no one else has received before. It all depends on your own status. It all depends on how available you are to receive this divine rain, this nourishing liquid that allows your Weltanschauung to be repaired and to flourish and to grow and to reach upward toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This also explains why our beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last messenger. No more messengers are needed because the text is preserved and the understanding of the text is directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why do we need more messengers? We don't. He was the last messenger because he brought this message, preserved, and made sure that it was in good hands for it to continue to be preserved, and that was the end of his mission. That's why our beloved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the last messenger. Why the Sahabas, or the inner circle of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, never explained the Quran? For the same reason, because they understood the explanation or tafsir of Quran does not exist. There is no such thing as tafsir of Quran. What we offer on this channel is just our own interpretation based on the revelations and the guidance that we received. You may end up receiving something much more beautiful, something much more encompassing of the wisdom and the knowledge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's great. That's all we teach on this channel. We encourage you to reach out for that mat to get yourself ready to receive that divine guidance. This also explains, and please pay attention, because many of you have asked me, how come you know and all of the scholars of the last 1400 years don't know? Watch this. The splitting of the understanding from the text is the reason why the Mufassirun got it wrong. They treated the Quran like poetry, and they grossly misinterpreted the Quran. Why? Because they presumed, like all other literature and poetry, that the meaning is inside the text. But with the Quran, the meaning and the understanding are not inside the text. They come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is also the reason why most people struggle with the Quran, because they have the wrong model for approaching the Quran. We've mentioned before several times that the Quran is like software. It acts on you. You have to allow it to act on you. Why? So that you become that receiving dish. And we gave that analogy in prior segments. When you're receiving the divine guidance, then you take it according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends for you to take it. This is also why all Western sciences of hermeneutics, meaning the exegesis of the text, the exegesis of the divine scriptures, which are taught in all Islamic studies departments, are irrelevant and they're futile with respect to the Quran. They don't mean anything to the Quran, because the Quran is not following their model where the text contains the meaning. That's the science of hermeneutics, that science of interpretation of divine text, which they applied to the Bible and came up with all sorts of conclusions about the erroneousness of various Bibles. That science, that concept, is founded on the issue or the assumption that the text contains the meanings. And that's wrong, that's false. With the Quran, as we just saw in this ayah from Surah Al-Anbiya, there is a split between the interpretation and the understanding of the Quran from the text of the Quran. And finally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that He misguides many using the Quran. Of course, if you don't understand the nature of the Quran. And that's why we keep saying there is nothing like the Quran, no human product whatsoever. You cannot come up with any text where the understanding is received directly from its author years and centuries after the text is written. No human can do this. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made that challenge to all men, all humans, all jinn, any group of people you want to bring, see if you can come up with anything like this. It is inimitable. This is the reason. Is there a proof to this? Only if you experience it. Only if you yourself go through this process, you will engage the Quran on its own terms and you will discover these aha moments happening successively, constantly repeating, and happening so frequently that you sit back and say, Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, I have access to this highway of information that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intended for me to receive through the engagement of the text of the Quran. I hope this is clear, and I hope this is making an impact on you, inshallah. Now, what about the methodology? Dr. Hani, you keep talking about the methodology. Methodology this, methodology that. Organic methodology, Quranic methodology. The answer, when you apply the methodology, you make yourself available to receive the understanding directly from Allah. It is not from the text. Let me repeat it. The methodology is not to be used to unlock portions of the text. Yes, I used that expression before to try to simplify the discourse that we were engaged in various segments. But the methodology is primarily to work on you. The methodology is a discipline that you have to go through to make sure you don't get misled and to make sure that you're making yourself available to receive the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's look at some examples, some verses and ayat from the Quran. Surah Al-Isra 17:44, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تُسَبِّحُ لَهُ السَّمَاوَاتُ السَّبْعُ وَالْأَرْضُ وَمَنْ فِيهِنَّ. To His predetermined way, i.e. in the orbits, we've talked about سَبَحَ يَسْبَحُ تَسْبِيح, which is the orbit. To His predetermined way, surrender all seven layers of understanding. And now we have a new concept. سَمَاوَات are the layers. They're determined by a count, which is سَبَع, seven. And the scripture's text, and must also surrender all those who engage in them, meaning in as-samawat and al-ard. So if you're engaged in that concept, in that process, and you want to have access to those layers of understanding, you have to submit to whom? To Allah, lahu. In Surah Ar-Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا مَعْشَرَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنسِ إِنِ اسْتَطَعْتُمْ أَن تَنْفُذُوا مِنْ أَقْطَارِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ فَانْفُذُوا لَا تَنْفُذُونَ إِلَّا بِسُلْطَانِ. O jinn and humans, and the word jinn, I left it in here, literally transliterated. I don't want to get into this concept. Please don't ask about it in the comment section. We are ready to discuss it when we are ready to discuss it. We're not progressed enough through our presentation on this channel to get to that issue, so we will leave it till later. So for now, I'll write jinn, but it's not what you think. O jinn and humans, if you can penetrate the fences established around the layers of understanding and around the scripture, we challenge you to go ahead and penetrate them. You shall not succeed except by the divine authoritativeness. This is exactly what we're talking about. You will not understand unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings down that divine rain, al-ma. From where? From samawat, the layers of understanding that he keeps to himself. And then he will give you parts according to your readiness, according to your Weltanschauung, how much you have worked on your umniyya, your schemas, how much you have submitted with humility, how much you have been patient, how much you have been observant, how much you have worked on the process of purifying yourself with ibadat and with diligence and with the discipline and with the perseverance, all sorts of things for you to become among the muttaqoon. And when you become among the muttaqoon, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy on you and start giving you in accordance to qadr, laylatul qadr. We talked about this before. Laylatul qadr is the night where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you in due measure. That's laylatul qadr. And that's all related to these concepts that we're talking about. We continue with another example. يَسْأَلُهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ هُوَ فِي شَأْنٍ. Again from Surah Ar-Rahman. Asks him, he who engages in the layers of understanding and in the scripture every day. Every day is a key word in here. كُلَّ يَوْمٍ. And this discipline that you have to engage the Quran with has to be a daily discipline. Has to be something you repeat every single day. Why? Because every day you are liable to engage in something new, to receive a new matter, a new thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens up for you. Now there are many dua, inshallah, that I will teach you and I will share with you over the time, over the future segments. And there are many other aspects of this methodology and this discipline that we will uncover slowly over time. So you need to be patient, but I'm just giving you the helicopter view of this whole process, this whole new Islamic cognitive psychology science. And inshallah, you will absorb it and you will engage yourself in accordance to what we're saying in here. And then finally, another example. لَخَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ خَلْقِ النَّاسِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. From Surah Ghafir, Ayah 40:57. Indeed, the guidance, remember خَلْق, we've talked about this before. خَلْق does not mean just creation in a physical manner, but it's creation in a spiritual, intellectual manner, which happens constantly and continuously for you, for your Weltanschauung. لَخَلْقُ, the guidance, spiritual, intellectual, etc., received through engaging the layers of understanding in the scripture, is more valid because it's coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the guidance received through other people. So anything Dr. Hani is saying on this channel is just the interpretation based on the measured reception I have been privileged to be given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I share with you as examples, not as guidance. The guidance is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The same. His guidance was in measure for his Weltanschauung. And alhamdulillah, we know from everything we know about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was the best at receiving the guidance. But it does not mean his reception or what he received of the guidance is applicable to everybody else. And that's why he did not do tafsir. That's why none of the close companions did tafsir. Because for every person, they have a uniquely formed and sometimes defective Weltanschauung. And Allah deals with them on their own premise, on their own scope of Weltanschauung. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them what they need to keep moving forward, if they keep moving forward toward Allah. But most people do not have the evidence of such knowledge. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Now we talked about ilm means knowledge with evidence. So what does this have to do with this ayah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that, for example, if you taste mango and you're describing what it tastes like for someone who is far away from you over the phone or something like that, there's no way you can communicate that taste to someone who has never tasted mango before. It is a personal experience. It is evidence that Allah provides to you and nobody else. And if you receive that evidence, you're fully satisfied and you feel this overwhelming sense of peace, overwhelming sense of conviction. Nobody can take this away from you. Nobody can convince you otherwise. It doesn't matter if you're the only person on earth who has received such beauty and pleasure and sensation of happiness. You know it's true, even if everybody else tells you you're crazy. This is the relationship between you and Allah according to this new Islamic cognitive psychology. And it is not just for Muslims, it is for everybody. The sooner we realize that this understanding that gets deposited into our consciousness comes from outside of us, from Allah, the sooner we can start exploring a better relationship with the Divine, the Creator of all the universe, and therefore our relationship with every other creature improves because of this understanding. We move on to methodology foundations, one more example, and this is a summary of the steps of the organic methodology. Remember, the organic methodology is not to unlock the code of the text. The organic methodology is a discipline you apply to yourself. So here I'm sharing with you some of the steps, not all of them, some of the steps that I go through, and I encourage you to start understanding to go through yourself. First, we need to learn to read the Quran. What does that mean? It's not just reciting the Quran. It is not just mouthing the enunciation of the words and the sounds that result from the text. And I apologize for breaking this to you, but most of us who don't understand what we're reading are really not reading. We are uttering, we are pronouncing the words and the characters and the vowels and the accents and so on, but we're not really reading. To read the Quran means that you're fully engaged with every word you look at. When the Quran asks you a question, you stop and you try to answer that question. When the Quran says, "Inna fi dhalika la ayah," in this we have just given you a sign, you stop and you say, "Where is that ayah? I need to learn it." When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, "I've just given you evidence," you look for it. And you say, "Okay, I missed it. I need to stop. I cannot proceed before I really engage that evidence Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just gave me," and so on. So reading is a proactive, very engaged process. It is not just a passive, you're listening with the ear or you're enunciating with the tongue, but nothing is getting through to the heart. Reading is fully being there, connected with the text of the Quran. That's the first step. Observing intently every character, the way a word is drawn or written, the way a sentence is split across two ayah, the way the Quran is making reference to something that you're not aware of. Every single observation has to be caught, and you develop the sense of observation over time. This is not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen in one sitting or even 1 year. Sometimes it takes 20 years, 40 years for some people to really extract enough abilities of observation to appreciate the variations in the Quran. So this takes time, but it is part of the process, and we have to learn it. We have to make sure that we start observing it. Those of you who have contacted me to try to learn some of these aspects that we talk about in this channel, this is the process I put them through. I put them through learning to observe, learning to link the verses of the Quran, learning to notice variations that most people don't even notice. This is a very important part of understanding this process that we're talking about, this organic methodology. Again, one more time, the methodology is to work on you. Methodology is not to be applied to the text. It's not an instrument you apply. It is not a magnifying glass that allows you to see more. It's none of that. methodology improves your ability to receive, improves your availability and your humbleness to be able to receive the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this divine rain. So by observing intently, the Quran will teach you, the text, the scriptural text will start to teach you, and it becomes like software that impacts you. So now you pay attention to the style, to the various terms, to the various grammatical inflections, to the various way of delineating sentences. Every possible aspect of the text itself becomes a teacher for you, and it changes you, and now you develop a certain amount of knowledge that other people don't have. Additionally, you have to ask specific and daring questions. Daring in the sense that there is something you don't understand. Even if you read it in some tafsir or you read it in some translation, does not make sense, make a note of it. Do the due diligence in order to open your Weltanschauung to be receptive. By asking questions, remember, you're recognizing that your umniyyah, your schema, one or more, and your Weltanschauung need repair. And therefore, by asking questions, you're allowing yourself to be ready to receive. You're emptying the cup. You're saying, my cup is full of junk. I need to pour it out, to dump it, and start to receive fresh new water, fresh new ma' from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What else? You keep reading and you keep observing, and you keep reading and you keep observing, and you make dua. There will be a set of dua, inshallah, that we will reveal in the future. We've revealed some of them already in some of the earlier segments. You can go back to them. You also have to fulfill all of your ibadat, all of them, everything that the Prophet ﷺ used to do, especially charity. Nothing unlocks your Weltanschauung to receive like charity, nothing. And that's why Ita' Zakat is constantly repeated throughout the whole Quran. It's very important to do charity, sadaqah, to do zakat, to cleanse, to give out some of your possessions, or maybe more than some of your possessions, because it cleanses you from attachment. Attachment to material things is the worst type of attachment, but attachment to existing understanding is just as bad. And in order to practice detachment as far as the wrong understanding, you have to practice detachment in terms of material wealth and material possessions that you have. You also have to wait and not rush. You shouldn't ever say, I'm not receiving. You should always ask, okay, I'm not receiving because of something in me. What do I have to do to make myself more worthy to receive? And don't give up. Don't feel hopeless. Don't feel disconnected from Allah. Keep on the path. Stay on the path. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised us, and He never misses on His promise. And you have to have that concept of certainty built into your process, into your whole methodology. When you receive dhikra, and we've talked about dhikra before, it's this spontaneous aha moment, this flash of insight that comes to you seemingly from nowhere. Sometimes it happened to me just as I'm stepping out of the shower. Sometimes I'm doing the dishes and something happens and it reminds me. Sometimes a comment comes from one of the subscribers on this channel and it flashes a certain opinion or certain idea in my mind. So that's why I keep telling you, I learn from you. So make sure your comments are polite and with the right intention so that we can all learn, so that we can all engage in this process. So this process is individual, but it's also collective. It's for the whole ummah. And that's why we are sharing all of this on this channel. We want everyone to be engaged in this process, to learn and to understand, so that we can grow the amount of knowledge and the amount of maturity and awareness within the ummah. And inshallah, you will be a part of this. And that's why we're sharing all of this information. When you receive dhikra, such a flash of insight or an opinion that comes out of nowhere, an aha moment, don't rush. Don't fall into the trap of becoming enamored with it, becoming in love with it, becoming insistent that this is the right answer. No, stop. This is the most dangerous part. This is the part where you have to really stop and show patience and show discipline. You have to accept that maybe this is not the right answer. So how do you know that? How do you decide if it is a right or wrong answer? There are two more steps. The first step is confirmation. The second step is verification. I can't get into a lot of details in this segment, but I will tell you very briefly. The confirmation means that if this idea is correct, it has to apply across the whole Quran to all the ayat where this term or this concept or this idea may be applicable. So you have to do more research. You have to hold that idea as a hypothesis. Conjecture is the word that's used in scientific circles. So this is a conjecture, and you say, okay, possible, it's plausible. That's what we did in part two of the series. We said it's plausible. Now we have to prove it. And we go through all of the other ayat, we go through all of the contexts, we go through all of the implications, what's called implicature, and you see if it holds water. The concept of verification deals with finding other aspects of the same idea and other things that relate to this idea and trying to find corroborating evidence to match this new understanding you just developed with this conjecture. Again, this is something that we cannot elaborate fully in this segment, but inshallah we will develop more understanding for them in future segments, inshallah. All right, we continue inshallah with the methodology foundation example number 5. As we said before, the organic Quranic methodology is not something you apply to the scriptural text of the Quran, as in the model of the Western hermeneutics. It is something you apply on yourself. It is something you use to keep yourself objective, to keep yourself disciplined, to keep yourself from making mistakes and falling prey to your shaitan. As we engage the Quran, we have to ensure that we're following the process carefully, not to fall into the mistakes that other people have made. This is very similar to the scientific method. Scientific method doesn't really allow you to unlock the secrets. It just makes sure that you don't make mistakes. So in that sense, verification is a must. In the philosophy of science, this concept is referred to as Karl Popper's falsification principle. And again, I'm not going to say much. Those of you who are familiar with these issues will appreciate that we use these principles within the Quranic methodology. Finally, there's a lot more to this methodology. It is not just about the few steps that we just discussed. There are principles, there is a special type of vocabulary that the Quran teaches us about this methodology. There are certain guardrails that we have to be careful with, and so on. There's a lot more detail, but this will give you a helicopter view of everything that we follow. And as you can tell, it's an intensive process. It's not a simple process. It is a process that takes time and takes discipline. And remember, we're engaging the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so we can't make light of this. We continue with the methodology foundation. This methodology, which is a discipline, is referred to by the Quran as as-sirat al-mustaqim. And this is something that's going to be a surprise to most of you. The word as-sirat al-mustaqim has been interpreted by various mufassirun, or people who talked about the Quran, as this narrow path between Jannah and Nar and all of this stuff, and it is not based on the Quran whatsoever. The word mustaqim includes this letter ta, which refers to the self. That means you apply it to yourself. So it is your own istiqama, it's your own self-correction of the self, mustaqim. And notice that I did not put a hyphen between self and correcting. It is correcting the self. This is how the Quran must act on you, like software. Again, we will detail this concept a lot more, inshallah, in upcoming series. By misunderstanding the concept of as-sirat al-mustaqim, and by not even looking for it in the Quran, most of the books of tafsir made mistakes. They went wrong in their approach. And most of you have asked me, how come all of those other mufassirun did not get it right, and you're trying to tell us that you are on the right path? Well, watch this and learn, and inshallah you will agree. You will see for yourself where they went wrong. Most of the mufassirun applied the style of the poets. They did not apply the styles of the Quran. They did not allow the Quran to teach them the ways and the habits of the Quran, the style of how it uses terms and expressions and pronouns, and where it delineates the sentences, and how it relates and links the various stories. All of this unique literary style of the Quran was not taken in consideration. They came into interpreting any verse by thinking ahead of time that this verse must match the style of the poets. And therefore, they viewed the Quran as a text that included the understanding and the meaning within it. And that was the first mistake they made. The second mistake they made is they brought everything they learned from the style of the poets and applied them to the Quran, as if the poets dominate over the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were correct according to their preconceived notions of what style they should use to interpret the Quran. But they were wrong according to the instructions given within the Quran. So the Quran told us specifically, do not follow the ways of the poets. In Surah Ash-Shu'ara, وَالشُّعَرَاءُ يَتَّبِعُهُمْ الْغَاوُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was very clear. Don't follow the ways of the poets. Finally, the more a scholar is entrenched in the style of the poets, in other words, the more an Islamic or Quranic scholar has invested time in learning the poetry of the Arabs, the further and the harder it shall be for him to return to understand the Quran on its own term, in its own style. And I know this is a big claim I'm making, but if you really think about it, you'll understand what I'm talking about. His Weltanschauung is so preloaded with all sorts of wrong assumptions that when he comes into the Quran, he will not be able to recognize the different style that the Quran is using for its own expression, for its own composition. Watch this ayah and you will be the judge for yourself. In Surah At-Tawbah, ayah 97, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Al-A'rabu ashaddu kufran wa nifaqan wa ajdaru alla ya'lamu hududa ma anzalallahu ala rasulihi wallahu alimun hakim. It is talking about the Arabs, and some disagreement exists regarding the translation of the word Al-A'rab. But Al-A'rab are those who use the language of the poet, who are entrenched in that style. They, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, أَجْدَرُ, they are أَجْدَرُ أَلَّا يَعْلَمُ. They are too competent in the wrong style to accept the evidence for the linguistic boundaries of what Allah has made accessible upon His Messenger. Now, some of my Arab brothers will say the linguistic boundaries, it's talking about hudud. That's exactly what hudud means. And when we described hadid, which is from the gerund hadda or hadada, is to provide the boundaries. And the boundaries of the linguistic style of the Quran. So hadid in the Quran is not referring to the metal, to iron, or to iron ore. It is referring to the boundaries of what the words of the Quran are supposed to indicate. And therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, the more you learn the wrong ways, the harder it shall be to understand the ways of the Quran. Because you've already preloaded your cup. Your cup is so full. You're so full of yourself, so to speak. You're so full of the style of the poets that you will not recognize that the style of the Quran is different. It is a different lisan, and that's what we keep talking about. It is not the lisan of the Arabs. It's an Arabic lisan in its own style. It is a style based on the pure Arabic language, not the language of the Arab poets. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues, Allah is the source of learning and the source of Quranic linguistic discernment. The word hakim is from hukm, which is the linguistic discernment according to the Abrahamic locution. As you can see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us very clearly, it's using the word ajdar. Ajdar, that means they're more competent. Yes, they are more competent, but in the wrong ways. They're not competent in the ways of the Quran. They're not coming into the Quran ready to learn its style. They're ready to learn its ways of expressions. And the example I give you here, and you need to internalize this really, because this is so important. Imagine you bring an alchemist from the medieval ages. Those alchemists understood chemistry based on the model of the four elements: earth, fire, air, and water. So everything in their opinion must fit into these four categories. Now imagine you bring an alchemist from the medieval ages and you expose him to what Mendeleev's table of elements. Mendeleev, by the way, is a Russian brilliant chemist who died in 1907. He developed the table of elements. Imagine you expose that medieval alchemist to what Mendeleev produced. He will reject it beforehand, because in the mind of the alchemist, the world is defined using a different model, a different style. There's no way for that medieval scholar, medieval chemist, medieval alchemist, medieval mufassir to come and submit without giving up everything he learned from his medieval sciences. This is exactly the same thing that this ayah is saying. Unless you give up your competencies, what you think are competencies, what you think are treasures you've learned, you have to give them up, because you have to submit to the style of the Quran, not to the style of the poets. You don't submit the Quran to the poets. You submit your knowledge to the style of the Quran. So gift number one, what is Allah's appointed promise? The word that's used in the Quran very often is al-wa'd or al-mi'ad. And again, we are continuing with exposing this concept of Abrahamic locution and methodology and splitting the understanding from the text. And all of these concepts are really essential to understanding Surah Abasa, which is yet to come in this segment, I promise. I told you before, some ayat in the Quran are not understood without understanding the concept of ard as scriptural text. Watch this ayah and you decide for yourself. From Surah Ar-Ra'd 13:31, وَلَوْ أَنَّ قُرْآنًا سُيِّرَتْ بِهِ الْجِبَالُ أَوْ قُطِّعَتْ بِهِ الْأَرْضُ أَوْ كُلِّمَ بِهِ الْمَوْتَى بَلْ لِلَّهِ الْأَمْرُ جَمِيعًا أَفَلَمْ يَيْأَسِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ لَوْ يَشَاءُ اللَّهُ لَهَدَى النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا وَلَا يَزَالُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا تُصِيبُهُمْ بِمَا صَنَعُوا قَارِعَةٌ أَوْ تَحُلُّ قَرِيبًا مِنْ دَارِهِمْ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ وَعْدُ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُخْلِفُ الْمِيعَادِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, even if repeated readings, remember Quran means repeated readings, it is not just the proper noun of this book, it is the intention of reading again and again and again. That's why the very first verse ayah that was revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was iqra, read. Read as we described it earlier in this segment. Even if repeated readings of the Quran give someone the illusion that they caused the mountains to move. Again, I put jibal, mountain, in parentheses here because it's not the right interpretation, but we will keep moving for now. So they have the illusion that they moved mountains with the Quran, with their reading of the Quran. Or the scriptures text to be fragmented, the way they cut it up, the way they took every ayah separately and tried to interpret it as if it was an island by itself. That's segmenting the Quran, fragmenting the pieces and the portions of the Quran, disjointing parts of the Quran from the rest of the Quran. Even if they seem successful in doing so, or even if they allowed the dead to address them, allowed them to address the dead, كُلِّمَ بِهِ الْمَوْتَى, right? Have communication with the dead in both ways. So they allowed those who died 1200 years ago, 1300 years ago, who wrote the books of Tafsir, to address us. And even if they use the Quran to talk to the dead people in the graves or make dua on their behalf and so on and so forth, even if they think they're successful, nay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, to Allah exclusively belongs all commands to understand the Quran. بَلِّلَّهِ الْأَمْرُ جَمِيعًا. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone is the command to understand the Quran. And then the verse continues, أَفَلَمْ يَيْأَسِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ لَوْ يَشَاءُ اللَّهُ لَهَدَى النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Isn't it time for those who believe to concede that had Allah wished, He would have guided all mankind collectively? Now this is clear evidence that the guidance is direct from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The text is right there in front of you, and you have repeated readings, and some people even claim that they have been able to be successful by fragmenting it, or moving mountains, or talking, or allowing the dead to talk to them, and so on and so forth. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says no. To Allah belongs that matter of the commands, and
it is time for you to concede that guidance only comes from Allah. Again, as we explained so far in this segment. Isn't it time to do so while realizing that those who reject shall continue to be hit by qari'ah? Qari'ah is something that knocks you on the head, something that almost makes you bald, right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using that word to represent losing balance and losing certainty. And that's exactly what we find in the books of tafsir. We're losing our balance because they're not consistent, they're not systematic in their ways of interpretation. And we're losing our certainty and confidence, and we're losing our veracity, belief that the Quran is truthful, of course, because of what they have done in the books of tafsir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is expressing it right here in this ayah. Isn't it time to cede or concede that Allah could have guided all mankind, even while realizing that those who reject shall continue to be hit by a knock on their head, losing balance and certainty because of what they have devised? And we've talked about the devising, sana'u, before. Or to have such knock hit them close to their comfort zone. Every single Muslim today, especially the educated ones, are having doubts and having questions. And of course, it's not helping that we look for the answers in our own tradition of books of tafsir, and we don't find acceptable answers. This is what this ayah is talking about. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ وَعْدُ اللَّهِ, until the promise of Allah arrives. So this is al-wa'd, mi'ad. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُخْلِفُ الْمِعَادِ. Allah never fails to accomplish His appointed promise. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about an appointed promise, wa'd. Okay, so what is this wa'd? And here, in order to understand this, we enter into this surah that I promised you, a brand new surah, and we're going to provide it is interpretation and its translation according to the organic Quranic methodology. So you see for yourself, what is this promise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided us in the Quran? And maybe, perhaps, inshallah, we are seeing this promise being fulfilled in these days as we live. Let's read As-Surah, Surah Az-Zalzala, Surah 99. إِذَا زُلْزِلَتِ الْأَرْضُ زِلْزَالَهَا. When the scripture's surface layer or text is shaken in its own way. That's the literal translation. Now we get into a little bit more details so we can unravel the hur. So when the earth layer is shaken, in here it's the scriptural surface layer is shaken, hazza or zulzila, or like a seismic event, like an earthquake, you see cracks. And when those cracks develop, it is split in its own way of splitting. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, there shall come a time when the earth surface is cracking. And remember, we saw an earlier ayat of Surah Abasa, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that when the earth cracks and the seeds start to blossom and to grow and to come out of the earth as form in the form of plants and so on and so forth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing the same scene, again using the same theme that we discussed before. So al-ard, the surface layer of the scriptural text, is shaken to where it cracks. You see splits, you see some fissures. وَأَخْرَجَتِ الْأَرْضُ أَثْقَالَهَا. And as a result, it brings out its heavy loads. وَقَالَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا لَهَا. And then the designee among mankind. Some people will be designated to ask that type of question. And inshallah, on this channel, this is all we're doing. We're asking these questions. What is with it? Why is this happening? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is providing the answer. يَوْمَ إِذٍ. On that day, the scripture shall express its true accounts. It shall reveal its secrets, account, akhbar. بِأَنَّ رَبَّكَ أَوْحَى لَهَا. According to the fact that its Lord commanded it to do so at that time, not before. At that time, not before. I hope you heard me. That explains a lot of the questions that you guys have been asking me. Why now? We don't know. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided the promise right here in front of you, and we're reading it. Now notice, it doesn't say anything about the Day of Judgment. Most interpretations of this surah went immediately to Yawmul Qiyamah, Day of Judgment. There is nothing in this surah that says this happens on the Day of Judgment. This surah is saying, Yawma Idhin, on that day, there shall come a day when this happens. So when this surah was revealed 1440 some years ago, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was providing a premonition to the Muslims that there shall come a time where the earth shall reveal all of its akhbar, all of its true accounts, according to when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded it to do so. يَوْمَ إِذٍ يَصْدُرُ النَّاسُ أَشْتَاتًا لِيُرَوْا أَعْمَالَهُمْ. This ayah is describing all of you viewers, all of the people in the audience watching right now, coming all together, أَشْتَاتًا, that means each on their own, each independently seeking, searching, trying to find better answers, trying to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You come to view this channel. أَشْتَاتًا, this is what it means. Yasduru, that means they come forth on their own. Nobody is pushing them. Nobody is forcing them. لِيُرَوْا أَعْمَالَهُمْ, to be shown how their divine Quranic lexicon should be produced and how it was erroneously produced. لِيُرَوْا is a verb that expresses that somebody else is showing you. This is exactly what this channel is doing. أَعْمَالَهُمْ, the word أَعْمَال, remember we discussed this several times. Anytime you see the word amal, amila salihan, a'mal, all of these verbs relate to engaging the Quran and extracting the Abrahamic locution or the divine Quranic lexicon that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used for the Quran. So liyuraw a'malahum, to be shown how their divine Quranic lexicon was erroneously worked or produced and how it should be produced correctly. And I hope this is what we're doing on this channel. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ. This is the good news. On that day and that day forward, whoever performs an atom's weight of the correct application of what? Of the Quranic lexicon that we're uncovering, of the Quranic methodology that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to us, shall see its good results. There will be good results. Allah is promising to you, even if you do an atom's weight worth of work in this direction, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show you the good. What about the other side of the coin? On that day, whoever performs an atom's weight of the erroneous application of the divine Quranic lexicon shall see its bad result. So inshallah, we shall not be among those described in ayah 8. We shall be among those described in ayah number 7. And now we come to Surah Abasa. Finally, this is not the end of the video. We still have a lot of gifts for you, but we need to move forward one step at a time. In prior segments, we've covered up to ayah 32. In this segment, we're going to cover the remainder of this surah. فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الصَّاخَّةِ فَإِذَا جَاءَتْ الصَّاخَّةِ. The word الصَّاخَّة, I need to do a little bit of a linguistic analysis to it so you can understand. And this is what we call the nested interpretation. So we come to the lexicon, the lisan al-arab, and the word as-sakh is sawt al-darb bil-hadid ala al-hadid. It's the sound made by striking metal against metal or iron against iron or something similar against something of the same nature. Now, if you take it literally using the word hadid, it is referring to the word hadid as used in the Quran. And I am confident that this is how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam understood it. But even if you don't take it that way, it is hitting or applying something against something else of the same nature. And this is what we're doing in here. It's interpreting the Quran using the Quran. It's applying what we learn from the Quran to the Quran itself. Surah Abasa describes this process as as-sakha. As-sakha. This is exactly what Surah Az-Zalzala was talking about when it said that the surface cracked and revealed its loads. So the word as-sakha is the plural of as-sakh or sakhun, meaning he who produces a sound by striking hadid against hadid. In other words, applying the linguistic discernment in the Quran to the Quran. And this is exactly what we're doing in this channel. Morphologically, the word asakha or sakha is like amma. This is only for my Arab-speaking brothers because they always question my ability to do these linguistic analysis, and I need to show you that there is a lot of depth that sometimes we skip over, but here's an example. Amma, amma is the plural of ammun from the gerund amama, amama, which means to make general. Khassa, to make specific. Khassa is the plural of the word khassun from the gerund khassasa or khassa. Kaffa is another example. Kaffatun is the plural of kaffun from the gerund kaffafa or kaffa, not kafi or kafa. Please don't make that mistake. Dabbatun is the plural of dabbun from the gerund dababa or dabba. And here's a shout out to all of those people who claim that a dabba in the Quran refers to this one beast that will come out. They're wrong, because according to the linguistic analysis of the word dabba, it is plural of dabbun. All right, so we come back to Surah Abasa. So فَإِذَا جَاءَتْ أَصَّاخَةً, we said these are the people who apply the linguistic discernment from within the Quran to the Quran itself. In other words, you extract the divine lexicon we call the Abrahamic locution, and then you apply it to the Quran, doing these nested interpretations and so on and so forth. So the ayah says, but when come those who make the sound caused by the impact of striking hadid against hadid, i.e. applying the linguistic discernment in the Quran to the Quran itself. On that day, when the individual deserts his brethren, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ, you are willing to abandon what your brethren believe in or understand or are attached to. وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ, and his mother and his father. وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ, and his companions and his descendants. Here we go again. My Arab-speaking brothers are pulling their hair. صَاحِبَتِهِ, that means his girlfriend or his friend or his wife. No, it does not. It means the plural of his companions. Plural of sahib. Sahib, sahiba, with a ta marbuta at the end, means the companions. All the companions. All of that person's companions. He's willing to abandon them, to desert them, to desert their ways of thinking and understanding in order to do what as-sakha in here. What as-sakha do. لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِيهِ. For each of them, for each of these people that we discussed in Surah Az-Zalzala, they come independently, individually, each on their own. For each of them, on that day, is divulged a matter that satisfies him or her. Beautiful, absolutely beautiful. This is exactly what we've been talking about. When you are part of As-Sakha, this group of people who are willing to apply the discernment learned from the Quran to the Quran itself, then Allah will reward you each according to your own level, each according to your own Weltanschauung. لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ, for each of them on that day is divulged or is given a matter that satisfies him or her. On that day there shall be وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ مُسْفِرَةٌ. On that day there shall be some people, like those in Ayah 99:7 up here, whoever performs an atom's weight of the correct application. Those people are described here. وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ مُسْفِرَةٌ. Their outlooks, of course the word وُجُوه is usually interpreted as face, but the Quranic Abrahamic locution of the word وَجُه or وُجُوه is your outlook, your orientation, your facing, the way you're facing, outlook. Outlooks on that day that are guided by the noble emissaries, musfira, from safir. Safir are the emissaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, they are the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're guiding you. They're providing you how to go and what to learn and what questions to ask and how to remain patient, how to remain humble, and how to receive this understanding, this divine rain from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So your outlook, your orientation is guided by these emissaries. ضَاحِكَةٌ مُسْتَبْشِرَةٌ, delighted, even laughing. And some of you have written me in the comments and in private emails that sometimes they laugh when they hear these things, out of joy, out of happiness. And sometimes they cry out of recognition of the calamity that we've been living for 1400 years. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is assuring us that this laughter and this delight and this optimism is warranted, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is causing this. On the other hand, there shall be other outlooks. There shall be other people with outlooks that are on that day guided by decrepit relics. Ghabara, ghabara. Now, I know the translations and the interpretations interpreted this word to mean dust, as if they're dusted or dusty. But let's go again to the linguistic analysis. Ghabara, from the verb ghain bara as a gerund, which means al-qadim wal-mutahalik, for my Arabic speaking brothers, archaic and decrepit, such as the description used for Prophet Lut's betraying woman. She is described as min al-ghabirin. She is attached to the old, decrepit, archaic ways, not the ways that Prophet Lut was bringing to his people. Ghabara, from archaic and decrepit. So these people are attached to archaism, archaic, decrepit relics that should be forfeited. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in this ayah. Tarhaquha qatara. These outlooks are afflicted by closed-mindedness, miserly attitude, to grab what you think you already know, to be so attached to what you were taught in younger age that you don't want to give up. And this is why we keep saying you have to open your mind. You have to approach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with an empty cup. Don't insist that what you already have is the standard by which the Quran should be understood. Tarhaquha qatara. It's a beautiful expression. Afflicted by closed-mindedness. Ulaika humul kafaratul fajara. Those are the rejectors whose wantonness is likely to be unrestrained. This is a very stern warning to us and to them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, don't be among those. These are strong words, by the way. These are tough words for people who are attached to the decrepit relics and who are afflicted by closed-mindedness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very straightforward in describing them as kafara, from the verb kafara, which is to reject. Kafaratun, al-kafaratu, the rejectors, whose wantonness is likely to be unrestrained. Fajara, very tough word, very strong condemning words against those people. Now you understand the significance of Surah Abasa and the importance of these last 10 ayat. And now you understand why we have to go through all of the concepts that we've covered so far in this segment. We're not done. We have a lot more to come. But I'm sharing with you why we had to build slowly but surely. And this segment is so long for that purpose. And inshallah, you're still with us. If you are appreciative of anything we've said so far, if you've enjoyed it, if it touched you in any way, please don't be miserly. Share with other people. Write a positive comment. Or best, make sure you're a subscriber. Make sure, if you are a subscriber, to click the red bell button. So now we come to gift number two. Remember, there are a lot of gifts in this segment, and this is only gift number two. The fear of losing the mother of all gifts that we just described. So remember, the mother of all gifts is recognizing that the layers of understanding are separated from the text. The text does not contain the understanding. The text does not contain the meanings. The text cannot be subjected to standard hermeneutics or to interpretation based on the style of the poets. The separation of these layers, understanding that concept, is the mother of all gifts that we're sharing with you in this segment. What happens if you voluntarily walk away from that gift? You surrender that ability to connect with the layers of understanding from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You decide you don't need this guidance. Istaghna, you are independent. You think you don't need such guidance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us Surah Abasa to remind us that there are such people, and such people are not worthy of being alive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused that prophet to die. This is why the story of the man who died for 100 years was told to us in ayah 2-59 and was mentioned in Surah Abasa. This is the importance of this concept, and this is the importance of this surah, that once you grab this gift, don't ever give it up, because it's the best gift to all mankind. Now, I cannot promise you when or even if it will happen to you, but when it does, I promise you, you will be in Jannat. Undescribable level of pleasure and happiness. Something I cannot express, because language is just way too short to express such pleasure. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised you that it could happen to you, and it will happen to you if you follow this methodology that we talked about. When you experience this divine guidance, it becomes the most important priority in your life. I promise you. Receiving dhikra does not have to be direct, by the way, as we said before. So dhikra could be triggered by so many different things. The idea itself pops up as if it popped up from nowhere, but there is a trigger for it. Sometimes something Dr. Hani says is a trigger. Sometimes, as we said before, a comment somebody writes is a trigger. Sometimes something you read or see in some other unrelated field may be the trigger. And by the way, some of you have already told me that you've experienced the dhikra. You've experienced Jannat. You've experienced this sense of pleasure. In one of the emails I received, this beautiful person described that she has been washed. She feels she has been washed with this beautiful sense of fluid, pleasurable sensation that she's never experienced before. This is what we're talking about, Jannat. Most of you who have written in the emails have told me that you look at the Quran as if it's something totally different now. Exactly. And this is the gift number 3. We think you're all gonna agree that this is not your father's Quran we're talking about. This is not the same Quran they told us about. This is the Quran that Allah preserved for us. So you need to tell your friends, neighbors, and loved ones, and let's keep learning together. And here's the beautiful gift I promised you. For the full translation of everything we've said before on these 4 parts of this series, the translation of Surah Abasa, translation of Surah Al-Zalzala, and all of the details of everything I've showed you in this series are included in a PDF file downloadable from the description below. Don't go there yet. There's a lot more to come. Just be patient. We're almost done. And I appreciate that you've been perseverant so far. Gift number 4, an important question about the timing of the revelation of Surah Abasa. And this is an important question that we need to address. Now, if you remember, we said that the traditional interpretation of Surah Abasa, which is based on Asbabun Nuzul, the occasion of revelations that are related to this blind companion, Abdullah ibn Maktum, etc., etc., all of that story did not make sense, and we pushed it aside, and we dove into the Quran, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed us to uncover the beauty of the true interpretation according to the Quranic methodology of Surah Abasa. Now, having pushed aside their story and having pushed aside their information from their Asbabun Nuzul, from their documented history, why should we believe that Surah Abasa was revealed before Surah Al-Baqarah? This is what they claim. But why should we believe this? Because their information thus far has proven inaccurate. So it is possible that Surah Abasa was revealed after Surah Al-Baqarah, or parts of Surah Al-Baqarah, specifically Ayah 259 of Surah Al-Baqarah, was revealed earlier. Who knows? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say this in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, فَمَنْ شَاءَ ذَكَرَهُ, whoever wants to shall remember him. Him meaning the man who died for 100 years. And therefore, we trust Allah. Allah told us you could remember if you want, and that's sufficient for us. We don't take any other timing information from outside the Quran. Gift number 5, forcing prior understanding and preconceived notions onto the Quran caused missed opportunities to learn many new things in every ayah. If you remember when we discussed ayah number 4 from Surah Abasa, أَوْ يَذَّكَّرُ فَتَنْفَعَهُ الذِّكْرَى, and we went through this long explanation about يَذَّكَّر and ذِكْرَى, and why the Mufassirun missed these concepts, because in their mind يَذَّكَّر and يَتَذَكَّر mean the same thing. ذِكْرَى and تَذْكِرَى mean the same thing. That's the style of the poets. That's the style of the poets of the Arabs of 7th century Arabia. That is not the style of the Quran. When they came in with their preconceived notions and their assumptions about the style of the Quran, erroneous assumptions, they missed all sorts of information. They didn't even know to ask the right questions, such as why dhikra in one ayah and 7 ayahs later tadhkira. Basic questions that anybody who reads the Quran today should be able to figure out. These are two different words. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose these two different words in two different places? They didn't even bother to ask. Dhikra, tadhkira, yadhakkar, yatadhakkar, all mean the same thing. According to the poets, yes. Not according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another example is the word tawalla. All of them interpreted it as he turned away or he moved his back toward the person who was asking. And that's wrong. Again, when you apply the methodology and the verification that we just described earlier to the rest of the locations where the verb tawalla occurs, you find that it does not fit. The verb tawalla means to reject, to refuse, not just to turn away. And again, understanding this one term will unlock so many other stories, as we shall see when we come, for example, to Surah 28, which includes the story of Musa and the two women. Aha! He didn't just help them. He rejected whatever they were telling him. And inshallah, we will discuss this in more details. I can just see so many of you scratching your head right now. I can see so many of you jumping to write me an email. What is this all about? Inshallah, just be patient. Don't write me about it. Don't write in the comments. We shall see the story is not what you were told. So learning about the style of connecting multiple stories in the Quran has been totally ignored by the Mufassirun. They segmented the Quran as if they were trying to interpret poetry. You interpret the poetry one verse at a time. The other verses, you've already covered them. You don't need to go back there. Gift number 6, Asbabun Nuzul, occasions of revelation, is a pseudo-ilm. And I mean what I say. It's a fake ilm. Because the definition of ilm, according to the Quran, is knowledge with evidence. Evidence. What's your evidence? Their evidence are oral reports that were handed down from generation to generation and a lot of disagreements among themselves. There is not a single surah in Asbab al-Nuzul, the occasions of revelation, where there is no disagreement about it among that pseudo-ilm. So that's not a ilm even. The word ilm does not apply to this type of knowledge. This is hearsay at best. It should never be a primary source for interpreting the Quran. So when we discussed who was Dhulqarnain, whether or not the Jews came asking Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that question is totally irrelevant. Whether or not they came asking Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Asbab al-Nuzul said, is absolutely irrelevant, because the Quran has nothing to do with providing answers to the Jews or to whoever coming to ask Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The fact that Dhulqarnain's story started with yas'alunaka an Dhulqarnain does not mean that the Quran was obligated to answer them, or worse, was obligated to confirm their preconceived notions or anyone else's historical or ethnic claims. Look at ayah 4:148. The people of earlier scriptures, يَسْأَلُكَ أَهْلُ الْكِتَابِ أَن تُنَزِّلَ عَلَيْهِمْ كِتَابًا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. The people of earlier scriptures ask you to bring down upon them a scripture from heaven. The fact that they ask doesn't mean that the Quran has to do it. And this is a clear example. يَسْأَلُكَ, exact word, يَسْأَلُكَ, they ask of you. So the fact that they ask doesn't mean that the Quran has to jump to their will and their whims. And those who do the interpretation on that assumption don't understand the relationship between Allah and the servant called Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The fact that someone comes to Muhammad and ask him a question, even if that story is true, does not mean that Allah has to jump and respond. Why should you make that assumption? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not confirm this in the Quran, and that's enough for us. The fact that some Asbabun Nuzul author reported this fact doesn't mean anything to us. It's an external source that does not dominate over our interpretation of the Quran. Whether or not a blind man came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has nothing to do with the purpose and interpretation of this surah. And finally, the general principle here, remember we're talking about Asbabun Nuzul is a pseudo-ilm, is not a real ilm. The Quran is for all times and places. Its interpretation cannot be locked into or made dependent on specific historic temporal occasion. The fact that these temporal occasions were not recorded inside the Quran prove that they have nothing to do with understanding the Quran, because Allah preserved the Quran, did not preserve anything else according to what we know from the Quran. So I hope you understand this Asbabun Nuzul proclaimed ilm is really not a ilm at all. And in case you're keeping track, we have annulled this ilm, so-called ilm, called abrogator and abrogated, and nasikh wal mansukh, in a prior episode called Does God Sit on a Throne? I encourage you to watch it if you have not already done so. So with this Asbabun Nuzul, that makes two pseudo-ilm that have been totally annulled, provably, from the Quran, as we have done on this channel. And I promise you, in future segments, we are coming to another pseudo-ilm called Al-Muhkam wal-Mutashabih. Invented keywords that people invented have nothing to do with the real definitions according to the Quran. And they made a whole ilm in fuqh and usul al-fuqh based on these invented words. They have nothing to do with the Quran, as we shall see. So inshallah, we have annulled two pseudo-ilm from so-called ulum al-Quran, and a third is on the way. Inshallah, if you stick with us, you will get to learn a lot more. I urge you to subscribe, like, and share, and please leave respectable comments below. And inshallah, you will join us on future segments. We close with the dua with which we always close. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله لقد جاءت رسل ربنا بالحق. Thank you very much for watching. سلام عليكم.